George Galloway's here. Hello.
Hi there.
How are
Fantastic
you?
Fantastic as always.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'm good. I'm boiling with rage.
I saw you tweeted that you were boiling with rage. Go on.
Purge. Thousands upon thousands of people have been purged from the Labour Party in the last 48 hours, including the leader of the Bakers Union, one of the oldest affiliated organisations to the Labour Party. Do not mess with the Bakers Union, would be my advice. And a young woman who was purged for saying she effing loved the Foo Fighters. Now, I'm not a big fan of the Foo Fighters. Well, I am now. We're going to be playing the Foo Fighters all night.
I love it. Every 5 minutes.
It's the mother of all talk shows. The last free space in the mainstream media. Here, you'll find something different. Here, you'll find something powerful. An educated, eloquent listenership and a presenter with the balls to say it like it is. It's going to be the mother of all talk shows. The country is going to hell in a handcart. The National Health Service is under unremitting attack. The international situation continues to deteriorate. The unelected British Prime Minister presides over us from an Alpine retreat, and Boris Johnson is in control of our country. Meanwhile, the opposition is fully engaged on the mother of all purges. There has never been, in the entire history of these islands, a political purge like the one going on right at this minute in the Labour Party's London headquarters. Never have so many been purged by so few. Precisely five, actually, though their identities remain a closely guarded secret. One thing is for sure, their goal is obvious. If I tell you, and I'm the first, I think, to tell you, that the number of Labour members now purged from voting in the Labour leadership election runs into the tens of thousands. Tens of thousands of their own members. That's the ones that escaped the court decision now. We're not talking about the same people. We're talking about purge two. Tens of thousands of people have been purged by a methodology which would have made George Orwell, author of 1984, shudder. They have employed software to trawl the alleged, I'll come back to that word, social media musings of hundreds of thousands of Labour Party members going back at least to 2013. The software is programmed for key words, just like Operation Tinkerbell long ago in the annals of the US National Security Agency, to seek out key hot words. In this case, those words include my name. They include the Green Party name. They include Caroline Lucas's name. And they include the name of the Foo Fighters. Now, I somehow have missed the body of work of the Foo Fighters. But friends of mine tell me they're a real fine band. No one has been able to tell me why saying on Facebook that you effing loved the Foo Fighters could conceivably be a reason for the Labour Party to suspend your membership. But that's what happened to Catherine Starr, a young woman, a former Liberal Democrat supporter in 2010, who joined the Labour Party, is in good standing in the Labour Party, but she effing loves the Foo Fighters, and that just ain't good enough. They said their problem was Trotskyism, but actually their problem is Stalinism. Stalin himself could not have presided over a more ruthless, merciless purge as the one that is currently underway in the Labour Party, minus the blood, at least so far. We're trying to reach Catherine Starr to find out just how much she effing loved the Foo Fighters and why that might be a reason for suspending her from Labour Party membership. We're trying to reach Ronnie Draper also, who's the leader of the Bakers Union. Do not mess with the Bakers Union. That would have been my advice to the Purge Committee of Five, the Gang of Five, the Foo Fighter Purge 2016. He's been purged for using a word in social media which was not a banned word and isn't even a bad or inaccurate word, was not banned by the NEC until many weeks after he used it. I'm focusing on these two out of the tens of thousands, not just because they're particularly ludicrous, but because both of them will certainly end in legal action. Now, the Labour Party National Executive Subcommittee of five unknown people is guilty, prima facie, I'm saying it right here and now on national radio, of multiple breaches of the European Convention on Human Rights, to which the Labour government made us a signatory. They're also guilty of multiple breaches of people's online privacy. That's leaving aside entirely the issue of whether somebody retweeted me and endorsed me and what I was saying in that retweet. Because, of course, I've got to tell you, a very large number of very prominent Blairites have retweeted me many, many hundreds of times, not necessarily by way of endorsement. It leaves aside the issue of who was using the Twitter account, who was on the Facebook in the name of the unnamed tens of thousands of Labour Party members. These are, in a way, technical and legal points. The overarching scandal is that whilst the Tories are laying waste to Britain, this is what the Labour Party's head office is spending its time doing. The big ugly bear, Tom Watson, that we've been looking for weeks, with our net, with our big pot of honey, laying our traps, unable to catch him, he broke radio silence tonight to say, in the midst of all this, I want to confirm that I have no knowledge of any discussions with the Green Party about an electoral pact. Nero fiddling whilst Rome is burning. Now, as I've said here before, the Labour Party is bigger today than it has ever been in its entire history. It is bigger than any other Labour Party or Social Democratic Party anywhere in the entire world. And Corbyn hasn't even been in a year. He's very nearly tripled, 300% tripled, the membership of the Labour Party in less than 1 year. They're still winning elections. In Kelty, in Fife, the land of the SNP, an old friend of mine, Mary Lockhart, was elected yesterday in a famous by-election victory in Kelty, and Jeremy Corbyn, I saw, was in Scotland and pictured with her in social media this evening. So the struggle goes on, but it is being not just handicapped, not just shot in the foot, but placed in existential danger by the reckless conduct of its own national executive, or a subcommittee thereof, unknown, five strong. It is risking the entire existence. That's what existential means. It is risking the entire existence of a Labour Party 116 years old. It's very, very serious. Yet we cannot get a cheap out of the Labour NEC. Where's Wally? We still can't catch him. The big ugly bear? Still can't catch him. None of them will defend why a young woman got banned for effing loving the Foo Fighters. None of them will say what Ronnie Draper, a union leader of a union that's been affiliated to the Labour Party for the best part of 100 years, suspended after decades of Labour Party membership because some creep found a tweet that he sent a long time ago on social media. It is almost beyond a joke, but it is a joke. And we'll be asking you for your Labour purge songs all night here. I believe that even this group cannot possibly purge enough people to alter the outcome of the Labour leadership election. Which begs the question, of course, why, other than a wrecking manoeuvre, these people have embarked upon this course of action? But I want to hear your view, and if it's a contrary view, I'll be even more delighted. The National Health Service is being murdered in plain sight by Theresa May and Jeremy Hunt and the Conservative government. And Labour is finding it difficult to do anything about it because it's, well, imploding, tearing itself apart. Jeremy Corbyn had a press conference on the NHS to launch a new policy initiative of Diane Abbott, the shadow health secretary, but it was wrecked by these low-life journalists who only wanted to talk about seats on a train. But one of the doctors who was there and who spoke at that press conference as a kind of warm-up for Jeremy Corbyn has been good enough to come on the show to talk to us about the plans that are being drawn up that could see savage cuts to NHS services across England. He's a junior doctor of 10 years, Dr. Rishi Dhir. Dr. Rishi, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you for having me, George.
Now, because no one heard a word of the press conference, because they were more concerned with the phony war over Traingate, summarise for us, if you would, what was said there.
So what was said was, it was actually quite a groundbreaking day for the NHS, because Mr. Corbyn was talking about renationalising the NHS. So what that means is, it means scrutinising where the money in the NHS has been wasted, particularly in the form of PFI contracts, and reversing some of those contracts or making sure they are strictly adhered to. What he talked about was taking the NHS, which is being privatised, and putting it back into public hands.
Yeah, renationalising the NHS.
Absolutely, absolutely. And it was quite ironic because there were 7 questions at the press conference, 4 of which were about Virgin Trains. And the footage which was shown of the so-called argument with the Sky News reporter, that was the 3rd question after one to BBC and one to ITV, both of which had been about trains. So that was the 3rd question in a row. So actually, I thought that footage was put up out of context. And secondly, Mr. Corbyn did answer the journalist's question. It was the journalist himself who was a little bit aggressive. So I thought that actually, it was a little bit insulting that on the day that a massive NHS policy decision was made, with a doctor of 10 years' experience there and a nurse present, that very little attention was paid to the actual underlying issue.
Well, they don't give a toss about the National Health Service. That's the truth of it. And there's a big job being done, isn't there, to make people conclude that the NHS is in such bad shape that it can't go on in its current form. That's the game that they're involved in. I hear it from right-wing people all the time. They say, well, we love the NHS, but it can't go on like this. And what they mean is it's got to change to something closer to the American model, isn't it?
Yeah, well, I think that's what they're looking for. It's a two-tiered insurance system. And I believe particularly it's not necessarily that funds are not available. I think that it's that funds are being mismanaged and wasted. And so by creating an impression of a service that's failing and by pushing a service to failure, you then make it a much more palatable option to then introduce private services. It's like, oh, well, look at this private MRI service, or look at this private service we can do, or maternity here, or so-and-so here. By shutting down A&Es, by centralizing services, you then create a palatable option because you give the impression of a service that's in failure.
Well, what did Diane Abbott's new policy propose to do in detail?
So, well, I was going to say to you, in terms of the actual interviews that you were talking about, which weren't publicized, I've actually tweeted them on my own account, at Dear Hunter, D-H-I-R-H-U-N-T-E-R. So I'm going to be spreading a lot of the interviews that were taken. I got someone to video them and
excellent.
Put some of them up.
Excellent.
Because, and I think, you know, we've got companies like Unity March, and also with my own song, Stand Up by Dr.
We're gonna play that in just a minute.
Well, I'm using that as an opportunity to try and get the message out and reach a lot of people very quickly. But yeah, Diane Abbott was talking about giving back the nurse's bursary, which has been taken away, and that's leading to a massive brain drain of nurses from the profession. So she was talking about reinstituting the nursing bursary. They were talking, as I said before, about scrutinizing PFI contracts, making sure that they're adhered to, ones that are rogue, cancelling them, and essentially a lot of the services which are being sold off and broken up, putting them back into public hands.
Well, it's a top-class policy. It's just a pity that the media conspired, that no one got to know about it. It's good that you have floated it. Just finally, before we play your song, what's the current morale, the current mood amongst your fellow junior doctors?
I mean, I'll be honest with you, George, the morale has been very bad the last few months. We felt as a profession that we've been not only discredited, but devalued. I know a number of very good colleagues who've left the profession to go to Australia and New Zealand, which is incredibly sad, but I don't blame them. Because, number one, then it's becoming more and more difficult to do your job. One thing I wanted to highlight is, as an orthopedic surgeon, I'm having to cancel 3 or 4 patients every week because of lack of beds, lack of resources. That's nothing to do with strikes. That's something that happens on a week-by-week basis. We're having to stretch ourselves so thinly across 5 days, and now we're being told that actually, you know, this amazing 7-day service on a cost-neutral envelope where they won't put any money in. And I think we've seen earlier this week that has been exposed to be a complete sham as well. So
Hunt was told by his own officials that couldn't be done.
Exactly. And one thing I wanted to highlight as well is that he, on the basis of that policy, that 7-day policy, he has tried to push through and impose this junior doctor contract, which has brought forward the first ever complete strike in history. And yet he's not being made or taken to task for that. The Tory party's not being taken to task for that. And yet, we're hearing on every single newspaper about Traingate. Now, trains might be very interested, but I, as a member of the NHS, I'm not here banging about supporting Corbyn or supporting Smith. I'm banging about supporting the NHS. Why is this not a bigger issue? Why is the issue of a 7-day service being lied upon and being used as a basis to impose this contract? Why is that not the number one issue? I really do question that.
Very, very good questions, and you've questioned it very eloquently. Dr. Rishi Dear, thank you very much for joining us. Let's hear a bit of your song. Steve, welcome to the show.
Good evening, George. How are you?
By the grace of God, I'm very good, but I'm rather cross today.
About the purge.
I'm kind of on fire about it. So go ahead, tell me what you think.
Well, as far as I'm concerned, George, there's a strange paradox here because obviously, people are very annoyed by being purged when they were able to be voting. But the paradox is, you can't get annoyed because if you dare not say anything,
you'll get expelled. Yeah,
infringement.
Yeah, I mean, in the last 24 hours, you know, I'm very active on Twitter. I have 255,000 followers. I tweet all the time.
Yeah.
I do it myself almost all the time, and the number of people
Labour Party members who have not been prepared to retweet me that normally do is really quite marked, because they know now that there's a software at the head office which is tracking who people and what people like or retweet on Twitter. You couldn't make that up.
No, George, you couldn't. You know, that's an invasion of privacy and human rights as well. Mind you, as far as Theresa May's going on, while everybody was trying to talk about Traingate, she was working furiously to scrap the Human Rights Act.
That's right, but it ain't scrapped yet. And the ECHR, European Convention on Human Rights, protects the right of all European citizens to freedom of thought and freedom of speech. And that has just been broken in tens of thousands of cases by this gang of five unknown people toiling away with their software in the Labour Party HQ, under supervision, of course. I mean, nobody's in any doubt, surely, that bigger forces than Wally Smith are behind this. These are real pros that are involved here. This is Mandelson, this is Campbell, this is Blair, this is big communications companies. There's big money in this. Very, very big money. Because it's very big stakes, Steve.
Yes, it is big stakes, George. I mean, don't forget the war chest that's been put in for Labour tomorrow, which I think is over £250,000 to combat Jeremy Corbyn. And that's after he wins his election.
Yes.
So it just goes to show you what's really going on. But another point that I wanted...
Go on.
Another point that I wanted to make, George, is I heard some Tory crowing on the radio today about how Theresa May really severely dealt with Jeremy Corbyn at Prime Minister's Questions, and it just absolutely got my blood up. You know, the one with the unscrupulous bad bosses jibe.
Yes.
You know, what an insult, George, to all those exploited in zero-hour contracts.
Exactly,
part-time work. Some people doing two or even three jobs to survive, to a man tirelessly promoting their causes.
And you're absolutely right, Steve. You're absolutely right.
From the worst kind of unscrupulous boss imaginable. You just ask the police. Or bad at the job, how about their immigration success? And those Labour MPs joining in with those Tory jeers.
Yes.
I could hardly even envisage, George.
Well, they were joining in. They're joining in with the Tories. They're joining in with the privatised railway bosses. There is nothing beyond these people. There is no tactic too low for them to embrace. Stephen Nuneaton, thanks for that.
You're welcome.
David is in Stirling. He's next up. Go ahead, David.
Hi, George. Big fan, by the way.
Thank you, my friend.
I watched stuff on YouTube about you. And I seen the Senate hearings and all the rest. And believe me, mate, you're a spot-on guy. You know how to tell them.
Thanks, David. Appreciate that, pal.
Right, for a start, I'm an American Bulldog owner, right? So I'm not even going to apologise, because he's a brilliant dog. He's a part of the community. Everybody in the community loves him. They come up and clap him. He's brilliant. He's no a hassle to anybody, right? Now, I know your opinions on it, George, so I know that's not going to cut any ice for you. Right?
Can I ask, David, how big a house and garden and so on you've got for this American
builder? I've got a big house and a garden.
Well, that's all right.
I've got a council house, but it's a big garden. It's how you bring the dog up, George. It's no matter the dog being vicious to start with.
No, I accept that. But once a bad owner has got a potentially deadly dog, you've got a problem.
Looked at, George. That's a problem. Definitely needs to be looked at. You will get your wee skags going about thinking they're all tough and all that with these dogs. But no, the reason I've got them, I'm disabled, okay?
Yeah.
There's nobody going to come in. I stay mowing. There's nobody going to come into my house and annoy me.
I'm sure that's right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But he's still a pleasure to go out and about with, and he gives me an excuse to go out and about. Come on, I mean.
Yeah.
So,
okay, David, it's a fair enough point.
There's two sides to every
story.
What is going on with the Labour Party?
Oh,
I watched that Hustings the other night there. That was unbelievable. Him saying to Jeremy Corbyn, you didn't even vote. What was that all about?
Well, it was the perpetuation of a lie that Jeremy Corbyn didn't vote to remain in the European Union. I know that he did, And I'm sorry that he did, because I was on the other side.
But that's just trying to bring the guy down.
Of course, bring the guy down.
Come on in.
Well, that's right. And, of course, it's become what the Americans call a zero-sum game. You either take all or you take nothing at all. They are, or to put it more historically, it's a scorched earth policy. They are destroying the Labour Party in order to save it from their point of view.
Their own means.
Yes. And there'll be nothing left. I mean, how are these MPs now going? If Corbyn wins in September and leads Labour into the next election, how can they be Labour MPs
going to the voters and saying,
vote for us, put Corbyn in Downing Street? After all they've said about Corbyn, how can that work?
And yet he's still putting out the olive branch to them, do you know what I mean?
Well, he is, because he's a very, very nice man, far too nice a man, in my opinion. And I do hope
he's going to
toughen up, and after this is over, he's going to take the measures that are necessary, David. And what's happening in Scotland? I mean, this woman who's leading Labour in Scotland,
Kezia Dugdale,
she's led Labour into third place in Scotland, and she's lecturing Corbyn on electability.
That's unbelievable, eh?
David, thanks for your call. You're a gentleman. And good luck to your Doug, the American bulldog. Julia J says, how about Mac the Knife? That's a great song, by the way. Co-written by Bertolt Brecht, whose Thrupney Opera is on at the National Theatre just now. And Nick Holder, a good friend of mine, is playing in it. Brecht is very apt, you know, for these political times. But he co-wrote Mac the Knife. And Tom, Turnaround, Julia says. That's another good one. Tom being, of course, the big ugly bear. David B says, what about red buffoons? Alex Wilmot says, somewhere over the rainbow, Blairites cry, because we'll never choose them, like in those days gone by. And Wayne Mack for Palestine says, Labour of Love by UB40. Very good one, actually. We're talking, of course, about the NHS and the Tory dismantling of it. The clear plans, now very, very clear, to take the NHS in the US direction. The implosion and infighting doesn't quite do it. The all-out war that's going on inside the Labour Party, making all of these things much easier, of course, for the Tories to lay waste to the country. Later, we'll be talking about the Miners' Pension Fund, an issue that was brought to my attention by the guest that we have got, a most eloquent man, a rising star in public affairs, Peter Stavanovich, who's a lawyer, helping the miners, whose pension fund has effectively been robbed in plain sight. And for two decades, £8 to £12 billion of miners' pension money has been lost, taken by the government. You see, the thing is, pensioners are not that thick on the ground in mining areas because miners die young. We're talking about miners later, actually, about the Miners' Pension Fund, a scandal that you will find almost impossible to believe. Labour purge songs, Labour of Love, UB40. Jason is on the line to talk about the NHS. Jason, go ahead.
Hi, I've been listening for the last couple of days about the NHS, Traingate, Labour, this, that and everything else. And, you know, I think politicians, for me, are seeming to shy away from what they want votes and they want to be, you know, women's rights and that sort of stuff. But my argument is I don't want to hear about NHS. I don't want to, it's a fantastic service. I don't want to hear about Traingate. If Labour want to get into power, in my mind, they need to start talking about fathers' rights and the rights for fathers in the UK and the lack of them. Shared parenting, equal parenting. And that's something that no political party seems to want to talk about. Do you know why that would be?
Well, you know that I talk about it.
You talk about it. I'm aware of that.
I talk about it all the time, so you're kind of barking up the wrong tree here.
No, I'm not saying you don't talk about it, George. What I'm saying is like, why don't the politicians want to talk about it? Why don't they want to... If Labour, if instead of Jeremy Corbyn sitting on a train making out that he couldn't get a seat, or he could get a seat, whatever the circumstances were, maybe, rather than talking about trains, start talking about the impact of not having fathers in the lives of children.
Well, it's not either or, Jason. Both of these things are important. The fact that thousands of people can't get seats on trains that they've not only paid for a ticket for, but whose taxes are being used to subsidise the private operators, that's an important issue.
Of course,
fathers'
it is.
Rights.
I pay £350 a month for my own 1-5 travel card.
Exactly.
I understand that. But
right.
What my point is. Why, you know, you're making a point about trains, but he is not wanting to talk about the lack of rights for fathers and shared parenting.
I think he should. I think he should. And when this is all over, I'll make an effort to persuade people in the Labour Party to waken up to this huge issue. An issue not just for fathers, but for the children without fathers. And that,
the children. I've not seen, you know, I've got the court orders. Court orders are not being abided by. I've got friends, I've got people that I support who have got court orders to see their children. There's no lawful reason not to see their children, and yet the court orders are not being abided by.
Well,
and the impact their emotional well-being that's having on the children, let alone the fathers, no one wants to talk about that. And I think a political party needs to take this by the horn and start actually doing something about it.
Okay. I agree with that, and I'm well aware of the shortcomings, which are systemic and I think fatal in the family courts system. And one of those shortcomings is the one you refer to, that a court can say that the father has to have contact with the child, but nothing happens if that continues to be denied. Jason, thanks for the call, even though I thought you were on to talk about the NHS cuts. Carl in Whitby in North Yorkshire. He's on next. Go ahead, Carl.
Hiya, how are you doing?
I'm doing fine, thanks. Go ahead.
Lane, after that guy, what he was just saying, I wanted to talk about parental alienation. And not just that, but grandparent alienation as well. And it ties in with the courts, because in Britain at the minute, we have a secret family court. It needs to be a lot more open. Since legal aid has gone, harassment orders and non-molestation orders have risen by 40%. Guys aren't able to defend the sense, and there are a lot of mums out there that are making false allegations and using the domestic violence legislation to keep dads away from the kids and using them as a weapon. Yeah, this is something that we really need to bring to the forefront. You know, I think it's really important that this is addressed both in Parliament and probably the House of Lords, because the law does need to change. I think it's really hard to get it across, you know, how important this is. We're part of a group on Facebook called Dads Against Double Standards. We have 7,000 members. We're not a haters, we're a support group. And we found that a lot of the people that are our members are going, it's the same story over and over and over again. It's just the names that are different. Mum and dad split up. Mum takes away the children, moves from relationship to relationship to relationship. Yeah, taking the children with them. Alienating the father, but not only the father, possibly the father's other children, grandparents, aunties, uncles. When a child's brought up that way, they tend to go off the rails a bit. A child that is in a stable environment, possibly marriage is the best environment, they thrive better. And I think it's really important that we get this message across.
Well, I'm the only parliamentarian who did take it seriously. As you may or may not know, I introduced the most successful ever motion before the parliament, which achieved over 100 MPs' support, including some very prominent members of Parliament. This is not actually what we're discussing tonight. I don't know if this is an ambush, the proverbial or the metaphorical camping on my roof. But in a way, I'm the wrong person to be pushing on this. First, because I'm no longer in Parliament, at least not at the moment. And second, because, hey, I'm on your side on this. But let's get one or two things straight. There is domestic violence, a lot of it. The problem of the lack of legal aid in the system is one of its many shortcomings. Neither the father nor the mother can get legal aid in the interminable, labyrinthian family court system unless the woman claims that there has been domestic violence, at which point legal aid becomes available. And there is no doubt that sometimes that is abused. Thirdly, there are many, many men, a very large many men, who are feckless fathers, who abandon their children, who abandon the mothers of their children, and who, frankly, deserve our contempt. Equally, there are many, many men, a big many men, who want to stay involved with their children, even though they're no longer involved with the mother of their children. And every child needs a mother and a father. They need a mother and a father constantly in their life. And the law's job, or ought to be, is to make sure that that can happen, not just for the father's sake, but more importantly, for the children's sake. And the miserable situation that you described there is indeed one of the melancholy reasons for social breakdown in our country. Of that I'm in no doubt. So thanks for the call, even though it wasn't as advertised. Guy is on the line in Stoke-on-Trent on Traingate. Go ahead, Guy.
Yeah, good evening, George.
Good evening.
Another week, and it's been another week of complete and utter terrible one-sided news reporting. And what I'd like to mention is, it wasn't that long ago, it was George Osborne caught the train from Manchester to London. He got a standard ticket. He promptly went and sacked first class. And a reporter from the Granada TV reported that the aide said to the ticket conductor he possibly couldn't sit standard, and he wasn't going to pay because they couldn't pay. Now, I'd have thought that was a bigger...
Pretty big story, that. Can you imagine if Jeremy Corbyn had... can you imagine if Jeremy Corbyn had A, paid for a first-class ticket, if he had B, accepted the offer from the guard on the train of a first-class seat, even though he had a second-class ticket? Can you imagine if Jeremy Corbyn had... The Tory government didn't just destroy the miners' union. It destroyed the mining industry when we had 1,000 years of coal under our own feet, making us dependent thereafter on imported foreign coal, on imported foreign owners of nuclear power plants, on oil that we had to go halfway across the world to fight wars in order to protect our right to raid their oil under their countries at our prices. The devastation that all of this left in the wake of the defeat of the miners in 1984-5 and the desolation row that most mining areas became, not just in South Wales, the most obvious ones that I know well. I declare an interest. I'm an honorary member of the National Union of Mine Workers, South Wales area, Mardy Lodge, since 1982, in fact. But throughout Yorkshire and Derbyshire and the North East and the Ayrshire towns and villages and in the Lothians, everywhere where there was coal, there was left desolation after the smashing of the mining communities by the closure of their industry. All of that is well enough known and is a very considerable injury indeed, scars that will never, ever heal. But the insult that has been added to that considerable injury we're about to talk about now. The miners, I'm sorry to say, partly because they don't tend to live long because of the hard working lives that they had, had a gigantic surplus in their pension fund. And the government set out to steal it. And they have stolen between 8 and 12 billion pounds from the mining workers whose lives they wrecked. Now they want to hunt them all the way to the grave, picking their pockets. A young man, a lawyer, Peter Stavanovic, is a prodigious, powerful figure emerging on social media. He is one of the new members of the Labour Party, is speaking up all the time for Jeremy Corbyn, so maybe he'll tell us first off whether he's yet been purged, whether he's a Foo Fighters fan. But Peter Stavanovic is a lawyer who, unpaid, is working in support of the miners on the great UK mine workers pension scandal, and he's joining me now. Peter, thanks for coming on the show.
Hello. Hi there, George. Many, many thanks for inviting me on the show tonight. George, you and I have met, and you know that I'm a straight-talking kind of guy.
Yes.
And for me, there's right and there's wrong. And having been a lawyer for 20 years, I think you've seen it all. A week ago now, I was contacted by Les Moore, and he's an ex-miner who had a story to tell which literally rocketed me from anger to outrage to what I guess I could only really describe as a deep sense of personal shame that an injustice as gross as the one he described to me could have been allowed to be perpetrated against our miners and our families. Now, I know, George, and you've just said this, that you've always been a staunch admirer and supporter of our miners. And like you, for me, a working class lad from the estate, these guys are national heroes. We know they literally gave their lives in the service of their country, working, you know, in the most incomprehensibly dark and dangerous conditions imaginable, just to keep our homes and our hospitals and our schools warm. Now, generations of these guys, George, paid into a pension fund, and they paid into this fund literally with their blood, their sweat, their tears. Many, as you just said, paid with their lives. They all sacrificed their health. Many are now suffering slow and lingering deaths because of the conditions they worked in. We're losing about 8,000 of them a year to chronic health conditions. And these men pay into this pension fund for one reason and one reason only. They want a better life. They wanted a better quality of life for themselves and their families when they retired than they saw the one that their grandparents and their great-grandparents had had. Now, and I get really, really angry, as you know, about a lot of these issues, but this, you know, had me bursting with anger. We get to 1994, and the coal industry is privatized under John Major. And a deal is struck which enables, as you just pointed out, successive governments to rob, and rob's the only word to use here, the miners and their families of a staggering 8 to 12 billion pounds. And I have to say, some of the miners I've spoken to think that's a conservative estimate. And it's leaving miners and their families destitute. Now, what happened was the government agreed at the time that it would underwrite the miners' pension on the condition that it could take an extortionate 50% of any surplus. Now, the Treasury's recently confirmed in response to a miners' FOI request that this deal has not cost the government a single penny. Not one single penny, George. Yet it's enabled successive governments to ransack the miners' pension fund of billions and billions of pounds. And of course, at the same time, the government's bailing out these greedy, negligent banker friends with purchases of loan and shares with taxpayers' money. So you literally could not conceive a novel with this sort of injustice. Now, we have John Major, who was the first robber baron, if I can put it that way. But Tony Blair then comes along, and he's happy to carry on with it. In 2003, when stock markets were depressed, the Blair government was taking a whopping 400 million quid a year out of the miners' pension fund, which actually threatened its very existence. And putting that into context, George, miners at that time were getting an average pension of about 40 quid a week, and some older members were getting as little as £10 a week. Now, it's difficult for me to even comprehend that the government, and we're talking about a Blair government right now, can rob the miners of 400 million quid in a year. It costs them nothing, not a single penny. And some miners are only getting 10 quid a week in return. I mean, you just can't make this up. The Tories, of course, were even worse. They took a whopping 750 million quid from our miners in 2014. It's just extraordinary. And I've only been looking at this for a week. So what I'm still trying to do, George, is put all the pieces together as to how our miners, and we're talking at the time 400,000 of them, could have been duped and ripped off in this way. Now, from what I can actually find out, and there's very little information out there, and we can talk about this in a moment, but from what I can find out, it appears that two of the parties to the deal were the government and British Coal. But, you know, we have to remember that at the time, British Coal was still a nationalised industry. So in reality, the government would have been negotiating with itself there. And the third party appears to have been the pension fund's original trustees, which, as far as I can discern, would have been just a handful of men making a decision that would affect 400,000 miners and their families. Now, I've heard stories from miners, I've not had this corroborated, but I've heard stories from miners that an actuary report was obtained by the government, and no one seems to have seen it, which recommended an 85-15% split in surplus in favour of the miners, which the government subsequently ignored, deciding to shaft every miner in the country with a 50-50 split. Now, there are many, many unanswered questions which Lismore and his group, the UK Miners Pension Scheme for Justice and Fair Play, have been trying to get answers to. And these questions are, was the actuary report shared with the trustees? Did they get a report of their own? Because you would imagine that the trustees of the pension fund will indeed would have owed a fiduciary duty to get one. And why was this not put before the miners? I mean, it's an absolute staggering scandal. It really is. And remember, of course, the deal was never going to be a risk for the government because, as you pointed out, sadly, miners have a very short life expectancy on retirement. And the government and its actuaries will have known this. So it's not surprising the scheme hasn't cost the government a penny. The government simply duped and ripped off good working men. That's what's happened here. I mean, the whole nation should be in outrage.
It is a frankly staggering story.
And, it is. It's incredible.
It's equally staggering that it's taken Les and his group and you to bring it to national attention. Everyone listening here, and especially every miner in the country, needs now to be writing to their MP asking them to investigate this scandal. Was there an actuary's report? Who drew it up? Why wasn't it accepted? Why, instead of 85-15 as a split, it was decided to go 50-50? Why miners on very miserable pensions have lived, and many of them will have died, in poverty with pitiful pensions when that kind of surplus could have made their last years on earth more comfortable after the hard working life and the trauma of the strike and the closure of the industry and so on had taken. What happens now? What's the next stage from the point of view of the campaign group and you?
Well, my view, George, is that there should be a public inquiry. There is no other way that our miners are going to get these questions, these unanswered questions answered. There should be a public inquiry. And I believe that there should be a renegotiation of the 50-50 split of the pension surplus to make it more equitable. And I think miners and their families should be reimbursed the loss this gross injustice has inflicted upon them. Now, there is going to be a rally in Liverpool, and every miner out there and every member of the public that wants to support the miners should know this. It's going to take place in Liverpool on the 27th of September at 12 noon in Derby Square. And I think this is going to be the largest gathering of miners and their families since the 80s. And, you know, to put this into context, I suggested to Les Moore, why not a march? Why a rally? And he said to me, Peter, we can't have a march because most of us are knackered by the job. We've got knackered knees, we can't walk, we've got chronic lung conditions. You know, we're literally dying. These poor guys, you know, literally gave their lives for this country. And we now have to stand with them. And you kind of hit on another thread of the story a moment ago when you were saying, you know, why did it take me and you to get this into the public domain? Les and his group contacted me last week quite simply because mainstream media was refusing to answer their call for help. And we know 81% of mainstream media in this country is now owned by, what, six different corporations, all with its own political agenda. None of them were interested in helping our miners.
Not many of them give much thought to the miners now yesterday.
They don't care, George. And
Peter, I've got a break now, so give me that date again. In Derby Square, in Liverpool.
It's the 27th of September. Liverpool, 27th of September, and we need the entire country to be there for our miners.
I give you a promise that I will be there. Now, we did ask the ministry to put up a spokesman, but they were unable to. However, they have provided this statement. The government has given considerable financial support to the mining industry to date, and continues to guarantee that pensions will be paid. Those who are members of the Mine Workers Pension Scheme have received pensions approximately 30% larger than would have been the case without the guarantee, and these will continue to rise in accordance with interest rates. What do you say to that, Peter?
I tell you what I say to that. It's almost like a silly analogy that someone gave me during the week. And the silly analogy was, some guy said to me, well, look, mine's asking to have money back is a bit like someone saying to their house insurer, I want money when they haven't had a fire. But it's not. This is like you having house insurance for a fire. And your insurer says to you, I want 50% of the equity in your home, whether you have a fire or not, and I'm going to keep that 50% equity. You know, this is an absolute scandal. You know, we want to know how a deal could have been struck wherein the government is able to lift out of the miners' pension fund probably, you know, I would say 15 to 20 billion pounds. It doesn't cost the government a penny, and the government knows it's never going to cost them a penny because miners have such a short, sad life expectancy. And it hasn't cost them a penny. You know, it's an absolute. There should be a public inquiry to find out what went on behind closed doors that duped the miners into this agreement that has robbed them and their families of the future they should have had. This money should go to not just miners and their families, but to the mining communities.
To the communities, yeah.
And destroyed.
Well, I'll tell you what, Peter, I promise you this. Now that you have brought this to my attention, as it was brought to yours, I'm never going to let it go. It's a matter of honour. That's Peter Stavanovich, an extraordinarily powerfully persuasive advocate for the miners and indeed for Jeremy Corbyn, and typical of the new layer of activists that have become involved in politics in the Corbyn era. And I think any of you who heard him tonight agree with me that he's a very eloquent and persuasive man indeed. Peter in Glasgow, in fact, says, George, go on and just call the revolution. That lawyer was amazing. Thanks for that. He was indeed. Let me take one or two more before I... Well, Adrian says, Owen Smith wanting to sit with ISIS is upset. Less. The media. Let me start again. Owen Smith wanting to sit with ISIS upset the media less than Jeremy wanting to sit with his wife. Well, Adrian, you says quite brilliantly. Even I'm bored with the train thing now. Cuts to NHS is a major worry, says Stephen. Kevin says the NHS should be set in stone. Welfare and policing first. Anything else whilst those are in need is misappropriation. James Ball says, I voted via email ballot for Corbyn a few days ago. I will not be shut up by nameless cowards in any executive committee. And my clever young men, Edward and Rudd, have, I've got to say this, you guys are red hot. No sooner had that thought crossed my mind, here's a tweet from the bear himself on the 31st of March 2014, and it reads, I'm having a Foo Fighters day. This does not happen often, says the bear, and it includes a little video of the very same Foo Fighters. So the deputy leader of the Labour Party, he doesn't effing love them, but he does have Foo Fighters days. And he does perpetrate their music upon the followers of his Twitter feed. Yet, Catherine Starr has just been purged from the Labour Party because she effing loves them. Tiggs has tweeted, give Owen Smith and Pfizer credit for leeching off the NHS. It's hard for me to give credit to Pfizer. You get my drift. And Fintan, who's a very clever man actually, says, call it out, George, this election is not free or fair. If there were foreign observers observing this process, Fintan, they would undoubtedly have to declare it null and void. I've been on many election observer missions, some of which I even led. Glenys Kinnock worked under me one time on the elections in Cambodia. I know about elections. I know what is free and what is fair. And I know the standards that international observers will apply. And this election does not meet them. What you've got is a National Executive Committee, some of which has already been voted out of office and is in the last 4 weeks of its power, setting up a gang of five with their software, trawling through the social media outpourings of hundreds of thousands of people looking for trigger words and actions. And anybody who falls foul of them is just purged. And of course, eventually they can get into a court if they've got the money. And eventually they could only win their case. But meanwhile, the election continues with tens of thousands of Corbyn voters being purged, in addition to the huge purge of over 100,000 people that was perpetrated by the appeal court of quite dubious provenance, without going into too many details, of quite questionable provenance, just a week or 10 days ago. That was the first purge. This is purge two. What comes next? Is it thought crime that will be investigated next? Is it the case that even if you've never said you effing loved the Foo Fighters, if they discern in your head that you did, are you going to be banned next? Drew Wingate says, I don't get the impression that Corbyn gives a damn about Scotland, and certainly isn't the answer up here. But the avatar of Drew contains unmistakable evidence that he's a supporter of Scottish independence or separatism, which might be, Drew, why you're so dog in the manger about Jeremy Corbyn. I think Jeremy Corbyn needs help in Scotland. I don't think that he's getting the kind of help that he needs from the Scottish Labour leader, who in fact has done her best to sabotage his leadership. I'm ready to help Corbyn in Scotland, and it's going to be very important that Labour begins to rebuild its strength in Scotland. But to say that Corbyn doesn't give a damn about Scotland when he's actually in Scotland right now, in Dundee, right this minute, he's probably on stage speaking in Scotland right now. Earlier today, he was at the Edinburgh Festival. Last night, he was in Glasgow. He's up and down on Virgin trains to Scotland all the time. To say he doesn't give a damn about Scotland is absolutely absurd. And you simply can't sustain that. We can talk about it. Richard Maunders says, Blairite thought police. What a disgusting state of affairs. And Jane says, have you seen anything like this in the UK before, George? It seems even more we don't like your guy than usual. Well, I haven't actually seen anything like this in the UK before, Jane. I really haven't, on several levels. The Labour Party has always been fissiparious. It's always been riven by ideological and political disagreements, and sometimes overlaid by personal hatreds. The Gordon Brown, Tony Blair mutual hatred pact almost destroyed the Labour Party. It certainly helped to destroy the last Labour government. There's no doubt at all about that. But I have never seen, on such a sustained level, such a deep chasm, such a deep, deep split as this. And it is, I'm afraid, ideological as much as it is personal. Because, frankly, nobody could sustain an argument that whatever problems Labour has, Owen Smith is the answer. Nobody could. I mean, this is David Brent on the front bench, as was. This is a man who's a salesman in an era of Bernie Sanders and Jeremy Corbyn when salesmen and women have gone way out of fashion. This is a man who believes in nothing, who has in the course of a few weeks metamorphosed into something like a political and ideological shadow of Jeremy Corbyn. He now agrees with Jeremy on almost everything, but claims that he's better able to sell it. This is a measure of the absolutely apolitical nature of Owen Smith. Labour has problems. Jeremy Corbyn doesn't have all the answers. Both of these things are true. But there is no question to which Owen Smith is the answer. Good evening, Ray. What did you think of that story about the miners' pension fund heist?
As we say, George, at least Dick Turpin wore a mask and he had the decency to wear a mask.
Yes, indeed. It's either 8, but it could be 20 billion pounds have been stolen from the miners in Ponte, which could have given them a decent pension over the last 24 years, but which has been stolen from them by John Major, Tony Blair, Gordon Brown, David Cameron, and if we don't stop it, Theresa May as well.
George, there's gentlemen in Pontypridd in the late 70s, early 80s, some in mobility scooters, scratching around for signatures to right this wrong. And it's a scandal, George, a national scandal. Are these the British values they keep banging on about? I've got personal experience of my father-in-law died of emphysema. He couldn't walk up the stairs. He had his bed down here. And he lived on oxygen. And he had a nervous breakdown when he finished work, George, because it finished him almost, you know. But, you know, I can't believe it, George. You know, we've still the enemy within.
Is your MP doing anything about it?
Are you having a laugh, George? Owen Smith? Well, my MP is Anne Clywed, believe it or not.
Well, she is, to be fair to her, She's very far from my favourite person. But she has signed the petition. I know that because my name appears a couple of lines underneath her. So to be fair to her, she has done it. But what about the others? What about Owen Smith? Has he said anything about the miners' pension fund?
No. Hey, George, can you get... You were a friend of Jeremy Corbyn, and you?
Yep.
Can you get Jeremy to highlight this matter? Because we got to get it out. The time is running out for these poor men.
Well, Seamus Milne, who wrote the seminal work on the miners and the strike in his book, The Enemy Within, I'm sure that he'll be interested in this subject. And if I've still got his email address, I'll send him an email later tonight on that. Okay, Ray?
Yeah, you and Peter together, you're going to make a formidable duo. I can tell everybody that.
Well, I'll tell you what, Ray. I give you my word of honour that right. I'm not going to rest on this subject until I've helped to get justice
Thank
for the
very
miners.
Thank you, George.
Thank
you're
you.
A gentleman.
Thank you, Ray. Lizzie, welcome
Hello.
To the show.
Hello, George. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you very much. Sorry we lost you earlier. What would
That's
you like
right.
to say?
Well, I wanted to say that I'm also a new member of the Labour Party, like Peter, and together with Peter and Dr. Rishi and another group called WhatMed Media, we've been trying to get these issues aired and get them heard by people.
Well, you're doing a fantastic job. If you're part of that group, you're doing a fantastic job.
Unity March, we're called, and there are 2,000 of us, mostly disabled and people unable to get out of their home. What they do is they felt worthless. And what happened was we got together and we said, why don't we use them as warriors? So they're called Unity Warriors, and they broadcast everything that we produce. They broadcast it across the internet.
You see, this is the power that we've now got.
Yes.
We
yes,
never definitely. Had this before.
Well, no, and really, I think it's all born from Jeremy Corbyn's propulsion into the position that he's now defending.
Yeah, and we've now got... That I accept 100%, and we've now got the tools. If I tell you this, Lizzie, if it doesn't make me seem too old, got to be careful because the wife thinks I'm only 45. When I was first elected to Parliament, there were no computers...
Yes.
Therefore, no emails, there was no internet, there were no mobile phones, and fax machines hadn't even been invented. And
yes.
and now they're extinct. So that's how far we've come. We now have the opportunity of using the tremendous power of people who can't get out of their homes for whatever reason.
Yes.
These people can be useful, feel useful, and be useful in
yes.
spreading the word everywhere.
Yes.
So if you're one of those people who can't get out of the house much, maybe bad on the legs or suffering from this or that ailment, you can still be a part of this great epochal
revolution.
Study.
It's a revolution.
It is a revolution. Go ahead,
yes.
Lizzie.
Yes, and I would say to anyone who feels that they're worthless and that they're not fulfilling their potential, please come to Unity March. We need you. And it's solely because of these people that the likes of Peter Stevanovich are able to speak, the likes of Rishi Dia are able to get their stories across. I've spoken to the BBC, ITV. They all say, we only want to talk about Train Gate. We don't want to talk about the NHS. Labour will never get in, so why should we bother to listen to what they're proposing? And it's that sort of thing that we're fighting against. And there's just, we have a reach of 1 million people. And every time we broadcast one of your shows, we get 300,000 hits within a day.
Fantastic.
So thank you very much, George.
No, thank you. Thank you, Lizzie. Now, listen, George in Chester wants to refute my comments about the purge. This will be worth listening to. Go ahead, George.
Oh, hello, George.
Hello. Yes, go ahead, sir. Go yes. ahead.
I'll just say that you have a very good name, but I think that's about the one compliment I can say. Basically, I will not take advice on someone who's a sexist, racist, rape apologist, to be perfectly honest.
You know that that's defamatory, and I have your telephone number, George.
I'm very sorry, George. I'm just saying my opinion of what you've said can easily be interpreted in that manner.
You have just made seriously defamatory allegations against me on national radio, and I have your telephone number. So let me give you this opportunity to withdraw and apologise for the grossly defamatory, libelous statements that you have just made.
OK, if I'll make you happy, I withdraw that remark.
All right, now get off. Now get off the radio, because you are a bottom-dwelling slug. And if you want to sue me for that, go right ahead, because you've got my telephone number too. Now, Sally says, Labour purge songs, "We all live in a state-controlled regime," sung to the tune of "We all live in a Robbie Fowler house." Thanks very much, Sally, for that. Very, very good indeed. We're still getting loads of these. Mike Nivad says, "No matter what he would have done, the spin doctors would have put it through their microscopes to find fault." That's absolutely true, of course. I've done this one already. This is from Edward. "Thank you, George, on behalf of the UK Miners Pension Scheme for Justice and Fair Play Association. Thank you for everything that the miners have done in this country." The mayor of West Yorkshire, I think, I'm not sure if he really is the mayor, says, "George, we both know the destruction of coal was EU policy, nothing to do with Blair." No, of course, it was Margaret Thatcher and John Major who destroyed the coal mining industry. And not because of the EU, at least not largely, mainly because they hated the miners. Abdul says, "George, even if he didn't, he's doing a million times more for us peasants than those selfish Tory muppets." Marie McFarlane says, "Jeremy Corbyn is loved in Scotland. We've had enough of the intellectual thuggery from Blairites, tartan Tories." And Tom in Enfield says, "George, you pay a disservice to David Brent in comparing him to Wally Smith. At least Brent means well and isn't nearly as insincere." Let me sincerely apologise to David Brent for any offence that has been caused. "I support Corbyn," says, "I just don't understand how people that say Corbyn is unelectable think that Smith is electable. The mind boggles." Listen, Jeremy Corbyn has won every election that's been put in front of him. 4 parliamentary by-elections in 1 year, all of them won by Labour, 3 of them with increased majorities, and the only one where the majority dipped slightly was in Owen Smith's next-door constituency in South Wales. Labour under Corbyn won the London mayoral election, the Bristol mayoral election, and although I took a completely different view, the great majority, overwhelming majority, of Labour voters voted to remain in the European Union. And it is simply wrong. It's untrue to say that Corbyn is some kind of electoral failure. Now, he has some distance to travel, but of course, that's not his fault. It was Gordon Brown and Ed Miliband who brought the Labour Party to this sorry pass. Matthew's on the line on Owen Smith. Go ahead, Matthew.
Hello, George. Big fan of yours. Thank you very much for everything you do. I just wanted to say, I saw Owen Smith on the telly the other day, and, you know, I can't believe that the front of the guy is talking about second referendums and whatnot. And I come from Wigan in the north.
That shows real respect for democracy, doesn't it?
And you know, I come from a long-held Labour seat from Wigan in the north, and you know, predominantly a working class area. And I just despair at where the Labour Party's gone. I really do. I see no way out of it. And to have Owen Smith come on, and you know, I know from a lot of the people I know were Brexit voters, and to have him come on and offering up second referendums, I mean, have they just completely lost the touch, these Labour, you know, the parliamentary Labour Party?
Matthew, Labour has a problem in UKIP stealing millions of Labour votes. And that's going to get them back, isn't it? By Labour kicking them in the teeth, kicking the 17 and a quarter million British people that voted to leave the European Union in the teeth by saying, we're going to keep you voting until you vote the way that we say you should.
There's nothing more annoyed me more lately than that, George. You couldn't have put it any better. It's just absolutely disgraceful. I just can't believe it, how far the Labour Party's sunk. I really can't. And I don't see any real voice apart from Corbyn. But I don't see how, even if, Corbyn's going to win this, I think.
Well, that's no longer a foregone conclusion, because tens of thousands of people have been purged, and there's still another month of this to go. There are hundreds of thousands of people who have not yet received their ballot, and don't know at this stage whether they're going to receive their ballot. So we can no longer, as we were doing last Friday, looking forward comfortably to another huge Corbyn victory. Because Stalin said, it's the people that count the votes that matter. And he meant that because he was an expert at making sure that the outcome was exactly as he wanted.
And I just think...
Go on.
Sorry, George.
No, go on.
I was just going to say, when the dust has settled on this, I just wonder, where's the real voice for working class people going to be? You know, if the Labour Party falls apart or whatever happens to it, I don't know how I can vote for it anymore. You know what I mean? I don't see him representing my views at all. And like I said, the Brexit thing and him offering the second referendum, just a kick in the teeth. I just despair with him, I really do.
Well, listen to this, Matthew. This is a tweet from Andrew Johnson. It says, we are witnessing the tortuous, writhing death throes of Blairism. Bloodied fingernails trying to cling on. That's what's happening here, Matthew. This is not about Owen Smith. This is about Tony Blair. This is about Blair and Mandelson and Campbell and that clique that took us into the cataclysm so perfectly denounced by the Chilcot report, which was wiped off the public relations map within 2 days by a coup by Blairites in the Labour Party.
I mean, do you think, George, on a personal level, some of these MPs who are against Corbyn, do you think... Do they know how the constituents feel? Do they know how many people voted to leave and, you know, the kind of support Corbyn has?
Let me just run through a few of them, Matthew. The great majority of voters in Owen Smith's constituency voted leave. Ditto, the majority of Labour voters in Tom Watson's constituency. Ditto, the majority of Labour voters in Yvette Cooper's constituency, in Andy Burnham's constituency, in Ed Balls' previous constituency.
Unbelievable.
Constituency after constituency.
Yes. In where I live, George. And it's just a blatant two fingers up to the voters they're supposed to be representing. I'm just disgusted in them. I really am.
Well, you've put it very well and very powerfully indeed, Matthew, and I hope that some of them, who I know to be listening this evening, have taken note of what you said so eloquently. Ken says, thank you for fighting for the miners' pension. And thank you. Jeppu 127 says, shame they call them as Labour, who fight only for power and no unity. Rebecca says, I hope people are watching the leadership debates. Owen Smith is petty, spiteful, and essentially utterly foolish. Rebecca, he's as empty as a shop window mannequin. Mark says, I'll retweet you, George, as I'm one of the 130,000. That's those that were banned in Purge number one. Well, it's been a terrifically busy show, I must say, and we've still got 1 hour to go. We've discussed the miners' pension. We're crossing the Atlantic now to talk about those other BAMs over the water. It's Godzilla 1 versus Godzilla 2, if you ask me. Donald J. Trump versus Hillary R. Clinton. But we'll be talking to the sage, John Le Boutillier, so he'll set me straight if I've got this wrong. That and the miners, and Corbyn, and the Purge, and the NHS. It's all coming up. Well, well, well. We've got one candidate rampaging around the stage, insulting every subset of humanity he can possibly identify, and returning over and over to attacks on some of them, against an opponent who doesn't seem to be able to get about the stage at all, and about whom more and more questions are being asked. They are both officially the least liked presidential rivals in US political history. It's a classic case, as Henry Kissinger once opined about the Iran-Iraq war. It's a pity both can't lose. Maybe they can. Maybe they'll lose in the sense that turnout will be way down. And if turnout is way down, maybe Donald Trump will win. Maybe he'll trip over the football, getting up to the toilet in the middle of the night, and those dainty little hands will unwittingly press the button and will be consumed in thermonuclear war. John Le Boutillier and me, we're fixed. We're already looking at properties on the very tip of the South Island of New Zealand, which we reckon might be just about the only safe place to be. But it might not come to that. Let's see what John's update is on the American presidential election. He'll be with me in just a second. Daniel Jackson, he's come up with another great tune for the Purge songs. 10 Paul Tudors over the hill with the votes of 1,000 men. They've been really fantastic, I must say. Levi Jordan says, isolating millions of lost voters. This highlights the incompetence and stupidity of the man. I don't know which man, whether it's the big ugly bear, whether it's Where's Wally, whether it's the people that lie behind the scenes. I don't know. I do wonder whether Owen Smith's second referendum is all his own work, or has he forgotten old skills and the corporates have got at him. Emilio says, never ever be afraid to retweet George. You are our voice, George. I must say, since I confided with you that my retweeting rate has gone down by 35%, that has fallen to 30%, so a slight improvement. I don't blame anyone who wants to take a couple of weeks off appearing to like or retweet what I say on Twitter or on Facebook, because these people are definitely doing what they can to purge anyone for any reason that they can, even if that means purging them for effing loving the Foo Fighters. Here's Tom in Gloucestershire on the miners and Owen Smith. Go ahead, Tom.
Yeah, hi, George. I'm really disturbed to hear about the miners, the way they've been let down. These men are national heroes. They are as much national heroes as our armed forces. The miners not only heated our houses with the coal they dug, they fueled our industrial revolution, and that's what brought prosperity to us all and put the great into Great Britain.
Indeed, and of course, by definition, they are growing older and more frail because of the hard job that they did. They can't have a march, as you heard earlier. It's got to be a rally because most of them, many of them, are not able to get about as much and they die earlier than others. That's why the pension fund has such a massive surplus, Tom.
I agree. And the tragedy is, at this time when they need the party that their forefathers founded to support them and to look up for them, what's happening, an element are undermining the party and destabilising it by plotting against its elected leader. The only three people I've heard recently talk about minors are Ian Lowry, Dennis Skinner, and the man himself, Jeremy Corbyn. And that tells you all, doesn't it, really, George?
Yeah, exactly. And Owen Smith's got a constituency in the South Wales Valleys.
Well, talk about long-winded. Owen Smith even makes Neil Kinnock sound a mite succinct, to be honest with you.
He does.
But I'm just wondering now who Hillary Benn and all of the plotters are going to vote for, because, of course, most of them voted against Jeremy Corbyn when it came to the vote on bombing ISIL. And, of course, Mr. Smith has...
he wants them round the table, yes. He wants dinner with ISIS.
Precisely. So this must be a bit of a dilemma for them now. Who do they back? They're not going to back the elected leader, Jeremy Corbyn. They obviously indicated that they would back Owen Smith, but if they back Owen Smith, surely they are the biggest hypocrites out.
Yes, they voted to bomb, and now they're voting for a man who wants to sit down with the ISIS. You couldn't make it up.
What an idiot, George, what an idiot. When you think of those images...
He's out of his depth, Tom. He just opens his mouth and says the first thing that comes into his head. And as somebody pointed out, the media were less upset by that. Imagine if Corbyn had said that. They were less upset with that than they were at Jeremy wanting to sit with his wife on a Virgin train.
Well, precisely. Absolutely precisely. But what an absolute idiot. I mean, when you think of those poor journalists who were kidnapped by ISIL and beheaded, and this is a man who's putting himself up to lead one of our great national parties, and he said he's prepared to sit around the table with people like that. I mean, it's just laughable. But going back to the miners, I compared them with our national servicemen, and of course our army and our air force and our navy people, they put their lives at risk when they go into battle. But of course for the miners, whenever they went down that mine shaft to do their daily work, they were putting their lives at risk. So that's why they're the heroes, as far as I'm concerned.
Well, you're right there, Tom. And I've been down many a coal mine in South Wales, in Scotland and elsewhere. And I tell you, to go down into the bowels of the earth in order to dig the energy to make the wheels of our industry turn, to keep our people warm, is service beyond measure. It was bad enough that they were destroyed in their working prime, but now they're being robbed on their way to the grave. It is a national scandal. Tom in Gloucestershire, thanks very much indeed. And the very aforementioned sage, John Le Boutillier, is on the line now. John, are we going to have to head for that property I've identified on the southern tip of the South Island of New Zealand, or is Trump done for?
I think, keep your ticket just in case, but I think Trump is done for by his own hand, George.
Yeah.
Political malpractice like we've never seen. A leading out who you and I might want in a race, we can both, in our own way, analyze the politics of a situation. And for the Republicans, this year against Hillary was a very winnable race. And they have ended up selecting the one candidate who probably cannot beat her because of his own problems. And that's what it's looking like.
Now, his problems are... of course, multiplying. He's not a billionaire, as it turns out. As a matter of fact, it's Bill and Hillary that are coining it. They've got a king's ransom over the last 20 years, much of it from kings, foreign kings. Of course, you did away with kings a long time ago. Kings of the Desert have been queuing up to give money to the Clinton Foundation, and hey presto, they end up with a meeting with the US Secretary of State. But $19,000 is all that Trump has raised on Wall Street. $19,000. That shows even what the big money men think of Trump.
Well, there's a little angle to that, George. I don't know how it is in your country, but here, when a rich guy runs for public office, it is expected that the rich guy is going to put a lot of his riches into his own campaign. And in this general election, since May 4th, when he secured the nomination, Donald Trump has put a grand total of $2 million into his campaign, which is nothing. And all the rich donors to the Republican Party who normally give big money to the Republican candidate, they're not giving. And many of them say, I'm not giving because Trump won't put his own money into this thing. If he's not going to put money in, why should I put money in?
And is it not because he doesn't actually have anything like the money that he's long pretended to have?
I'm sure it's true. He says he's worth $10 billion with a B, $10 billion. Now, I don't know what he's worth. I'm up here at a conference in Newport, Rhode Island, and a financial guy yesterday said that he and some other people have analyzed Trump's money, and he actually has a total of $168 million, not $10
billion. Yeah,
so I don't know
that.
What he's got. Sounds like a lot of money, but, I mean, he should have, the day he won the nomination, however he had to do it, he should have put $500 million into his own campaign and then purchased the best campaign advisors, pollsters, get out the vote operation, computer operation. He should have had a state-of-the-art campaign. But he's so arrogant. In May, he stated publicly, that stuff doesn't matter. It's very overrated. The candidate is the key to the whole thing. And he is wrong. You and I know the candidate's crucial, but so is the campaign apparatus behind him.
Instead,
all of this stuff together.
Instead of that, John, he's dredging the far right, how would one call it, the kind of internet sphere. He's dredging it. He's now put the head of Breitbart, the worst attack dogs, like Trump himself wasn't a savage enough attack dog. They've hired somebody even more rabid as an attack dog, the head of Breitbart, to be in charge of his campaign.
Yeah, they call it over here the alt-right, A-L-T-right, standing for alternative right. It's the far right. It's white supremacists. It's conspiracy theorists. It's the fringe of the Republican Party. And that has sort of taken over the Republican Party with Trump and this guy, Steve Bannon, the guy you're talking about, the head of Breitbart, who's a whack job. And they're running the campaign. And, now, it's a weird year here in America. That's why when you said we need that property in New Zealand, I don't want to give up the lease that you and I have.
We better not. I'll tell you what I've got for you, John.
Listeners are welcome.
Next time you're on, John, we're going to have an estate agent from the South Island in New Zealand because he's identified a couple of really plum properties for you and me. But let's turn our attention to Hillary Clinton. Now, I'm an experienced observer, and I can see that she's not getting about with the ease that one would hope a putative president of the United States would be getting about. She's slow, she's bad on the legs, she's sitting down on stools, she's having to get handrails put on Joe Biden's house so she can climb up the stairs without embarrassment. There are mounting reports about her physical health, and maybe even one or two wondering whether she's as compos mentis as she used to be, and that was formidably compos mentis, as we know. And thus people are starting to look more closely at her VP running mate, because if Hillary, of course, gets elected but doesn't stay the course, her health lets her down, he'll be, without anyone voting for him directly, he'll be the President of the United States. What is the political class thinking about that angle?
Well, I don't think that, I don't buy the Hillary is sick thing. I don't buy it. I think this has been put out by Fox News, where I have my own show, by the way. But I don't buy it. Hillary, I watch Hillary at every event that I can on TV. A friend of mine just interviewed her for CBS and said she talked to her for half an hour in person. And I asked her, I said, did Hillary seem okay to you? She said, she seemed fine, totally fine. She looks fine. This is the creation, again, of this alternative right conspiracy theory nonsense to find something to beat Hillary with, because nothing's working. Even the email thing, which they spent a year promoting, is not doing the job. Hillary's ahead, George, in every poll in virtually every state.
By what margin, John?
Okay, so I can give you some margins. Nationally, the average of the polls, she's ahead by 7 points. Some polls have her ahead by double digits, but we'll take the average, be fair about it. The average, 6 or 7 points. Now, we don't do it nationally. Of course, we do it state by state. We add up the electoral votes to get to 270 electoral votes. Here, I'm going to give you a few states. She's ahead in the following states by the following margin. Pennsylvania by 11 points. Michigan by 10. New Hampshire by 15. Colorado by 13. Virginia, 14. Florida, 3 or 4. Ohio, 5. Tied in Iowa, basically tied in Nevada. Trump is basically not ahead anywhere in any poll in any swing battleground state. And I think that tells us why we probably don't have to go to New Zealand.
Well, but we'll keep, as you say, we'll keep our reservation, and we'll keep this estate agent on a string just in case. Because it ain't over yet, not till the fat lady sings. John Labutille, congratulations on your new TV show. Pity it's on Fox News, but hey, we can only work where we get the offer to work. John Labutille, thank you very much indeed for joining
George.
Us.
Thank you, George.
God bless you. Go ahead, Ricky.
Hello, George.
Hi,
I'm
mate.
A huge, huge fan of yours, by the way.
Thank you, Paul.
Right, thank you for having the cocky, my friend. All I wanted to say was, I was just wondering, if Owen Smith actually won, God forbid, but if he did, what kudos would there be in it for him?
Exactly.
How could he sleep at night knowing exactly how he's won?
What honour could there be? What honour could there be, Ricky?
That
hundreds of thousands of people were purged in order for you to be elected. How could that possibly be a sustainable position?
Yeah, there has to be someone. I mean, you and several others are the only people that appear to have any credibility in politics now, including Mr. Corbyn. But I couldn't get my head around the fact that if he actually won, how could the man sleep at night?
Well, of course, the very forces that are now willing him on would then be saying, but you're only the Labour leader because you rigged the ballot. Tories would be saying it every time they stood up and they faced him. The media barons that are backing him now would turn on him as an ersatz leader. He wouldn't survive. Smith would be himself forced out by some of the bigger people that are behind him, Rick.
Yeah, absolutely, George. I mean, there's little he could do now to gain any favour from me, but I would have respect for the man if he won and then declined to take the seat because of what had happened. That would be something in his favour.
Yeah, I mean, we don't know. I mean, I said last week, and the bookies were saying, and everyone was saying, that Corbyn couldn't lose this contest. So vast is the electorate now. But if these people sit 24 hours a day, every day, cutting out tens of thousands of people, then that begins to be more questionable, doesn't it?
Well, I can't believe how it's been done. I can't believe this country, whether it's ever been true or not, this country is supposed to be, you know, we preach fair play to the world and playing a straight bat and all this garbage.
Yeah.
What's happened here? It's blatant.
Ricky, just let me ask you this. What would the media be saying tonight if Jeremy Corbyn and John McDonnell were sitting in the Labour headquarters using software specially developed to go through the social media of hundreds of thousands of people going back years and purging them from a vote? If this was being done by Corbyn and McDonnell, what would the media outrage be?
George, to use a religious term, they would have crucified him.
Yeah.
Really?
They would. They would.
Literally as well as figuratively.
Yes.
You know.
Well, he's got the right initials. Ricky, thanks for your call.
Thank you,
gentleman. Thanks.
Thank you very much, by the way. Bye-bye.
Now, Jeppu127 says, how can anyone be a leader without self-respect? It's the point that Ricky was just making, really. Hi, George. I'm a supporter of yours and joined the Labour Party following your call for people to support Corbyn in the wake of the chicken coup. I deliberately did not submit my Twitter handle or Facebook profile when I registered because I thought something like this purge might happen. I voted for Corbyn electronically a few days ago, and I'm sure he will still win despite these Stalinist tactics. However, I won't be satisfied until you and Ken Livingstone are rightfully admitted back into the party. Thank you for that. That's an anonymous texter. Isn't that something, that people have to remain anonymous because of the current and prevailing attitude? Farla Hines says, every US president in the past 100 years has been a warmonger, brave exceptions being JFK and Jimmy Carter. And there's a doubt even about them, Farla, I must say, though, of course, I'm an admirer of Jack Kennedy in particular. China says, Labour of the past, probably, but New Labour, on the other hand, is funded and intended for the oligarchs and not the people. Shamsan Kasim says, George, can I ask, what is the situation with your suspension? You're so needed right now. Well, I was expelled, not suspended, in 2003. Jeremy Corbyn was demonstrating outside, and Michael Foote and Tony Benn were giving evidence inside in my support. But it didn't matter, because a kangaroo court had already been told by Tony Blair that I had to be expelled after 36 years of membership, in which I had served at every level and had been three times elected as an MP, winning a seat off Roy Jenkins, the former leader of the SDP and one of the big figures in post-war British politics. So my position, Shamsan, is this, that I demand that my expulsion be rescinded, be cancelled, and I be reinstated into the Labour Party. And if that happens, I will do a job, a good job, I think, for the Labour Party. I have some skills, I have a lot of experience, I have a lot of platforms on which I reach a lot of people. But if they don't rescind my expulsion, well, I'll just continue to do my work outside. I think Labour would be passing up an opportunity if they force me to do that. Damien, welcome to the show.
Good evening, George.
Good evening to you.
George, there were two premises that I wanted to challenge this evening. The first one you've already covered. Owen Smith's entire pitch was based on the premise that he holds similar views to Jeremy Corbyn. Some might say plagiaristically so, but that he was more electable than Mr. Corbyn.
Yeah.
Now, as of this week, that claim has proved to be an utter falsehood. So what Mr. Smith has done by refusing to abide by the democratic will of over 17 million people, which is 52% of the electorate, and I think it's worth noting that there were 44 million voters, which is 2 million more than voted in the last general election, George.
That's right.
Now, by saying that he's going to ignore their democratic will, he's effectively committed electoral suicide for the Let On
Party. It is, and even right-wing people have said that. I heard one of them on Talk Radio earlier, Mr. Mills, who's a big supporter of Brexit, but who's on the right wing of the Labour Party, and H. Corbyn is making the point that Smith rendered himself completely unelectable by this statement.
Well, if he's attempting to wipe Mr. Miliband's 35% strategy, we saw how that went last time. Now, the second premise that I wanted to challenge, George, is the justification that's been used by the plotting MPs to attempt to undermine Her Majesty's loyal opposition. And that justification that they've used is that they have a mandate from 9 million voters. Now, I'd like to invite the listener at this point, George, to engage in a very simple experiment to test the veracity of that claim. So when we all attend the polling station, we're handed a ballot paper. We then enter the polling booth itself. So my question to the listener is this. What is the first name that you look for on that ballot paper to make your mark?
Well, there's no doubt at all it's the party. Not just its name, but increasingly nowadays its symbol.
Exactly, George. So I think I've made that point, and I think it's quite clear, and everyone at home who has had that shared experience will be able to acknowledge that for themselves. And the final point that I'd like to make, George, is in this country, for whatever reason, and we simply haven't got time to examine it too deeply, but people like a strong leader, whether it's for historical reasons, whether it's inculcation by the media, that's what they like, and you've got to give the public what they want. So I would say that all things considered, and everything that's happened in this campaign, Mr. Corbyn would be well within his rights to take very severe action against the plotters. Now, these are actually, for all the talking down that Owen Smith does of the Labour Party, these are very exciting times. Under Mr. Corbyn, the membership has almost tripled to 600,000. We are now the largest party in Europe. We have the most effective campaigning machine in the country. We are able to raise, thanks to Mr. Corbyn being an asset, £4 million in funds for the party in 48 hours. Now, we have an excellent electoral record under Mr. Corbyn. We've won all the mayoral elections, all the by-elections, and increased our share of the vote in the country by 4%. So we are certainly on course to win the next general election. And I would suggest that if it takes the sacrifice of a few saboteurs who are trying to prevent that outcome, then so be it, George.
Amen. I agree with every word you've said, Damien. Thanks for that call. Now, Mark in Liverpool, he's the fellow you may recall who only reads the papers when he's in prison, thinks I've been disgraceful for running the Labour Party into the ground. So we better hear from him. Go on yourself, Mark.
Hello, George. You're all right, mate?
I'm okay, yes, but I'm a bit upset. I'm a bit upset about what you think I've been doing.
Yeah, I think it's absolutely terrible, and I think some of your callers, just as you said to me last week, away with the programme, not having a computer, yous aren't with the programme, none of yous, you said absolutely mad, yous are running this party into the ground. Even your last caller, just crying out himself, can he? Plagiarism. What plagiarism? These are hard four. These are hardcore concrete Labour beliefs.
No, but he didn't have them before he started. Well, hold on a second. Owen Smith didn't have any of those beliefs before he started this campaign. He supported the Iraq War. He said it was a noble, in the noble tradition of British internationalism. He didn't support nationalisation of the public utilities. He didn't oppose austerity. In fact, he supported austerity. And that was only a few weeks ago. Now, hail, hail, he has been converted. That's wonderful. But you'll forgive us if we're a bit doubtful as to his sincerity, Mark.
No, but George, how do you know it was all that? It weren't all that right.
Because he voted. Because I know how he voted. Look, I know how he voted in Parliament. I know what he said on the public record. You obviously don't.
George, if you want to pick, if you want to pick specific moments which were terrible moments and big misjudgments and errors by him, that's all right. But what it is, if someone's had an idea, right, they've gone forward and put themselves forward for an election with Jeremy Corbyn. Jeremy Corbyn wants this every year. How mad's that? If I was a PR man on the
Tory side... It's not Jeremy Corbyn that wants it every year. It's the Blairites that are threatening it every year.
He won a re-election every year.
No, it's the Blairites that are promising a leadership contest to dominate each year until it's voted on in August, September. That's what they have promised.
Well, how can they promise? How can he promise anything if Jeremy Corbyn's the leader?
Because they say they're going to challenge him every year.
So was Owen Smith to come out with that as well?
Yes, they're going to challenge him every single year.
Well, listen, all right, George, I apologise to your better knowledge, and I've took that the wrong way. What right. I'm worried about, right, what I'm worried about is this, mate, is it just thing people call the Nasty Party the Tory Party. That's how I feel about our party in the at the minute. There's nastiness, there's sourness, there's pettiness, and it's all sounding no good. If I was a Tory PR man, and
it's
I was going
disaster.
Through all the airwaves,
you're
let me
right.
finish this point, mate.
Yeah.
I'm going through all the airwaves to see where it was getting me next cannon fodder. I'd listen to this and sit back if I was a Tory and say, we don't have to lift a finger. They're murdering themselves.
Mark, I agree with that. That's exactly why this leadership challenge should never have been mounted. Corbyn was only elected not 12 months ago, Mark. Why didn't they give him a chance to show us what he could do as the leader of the Labour Party? Why did they challenge him within months of his overwhelming election? And that's what's caused this. It's the coup that was mounted within a few months, maybe weeks, of his election. That's why we're in this situation now. Now, Mark, listen to me. I'm up in Liverpool a lot now. I'm doing a lot of things in Liverpool, not all of which I can talk about right at this moment. I'd never meet anybody in Liverpool who hates Corbyn the way you hate him.
George, I've told you many times, I don't hate Jeremy Corbyn. Policy-wise, he's the closest to my heart.
Well, you're always attacking him on here.
I have never attacked them on yet. What I'm attacking is the attitude of Labour supporters between anyone who goes against them or any other issue.
But this shouldn't.
I don't think Jeremy Corbyn, George.
But Mark, he's only just been elected. Why are they challenging him in this totally destructive way? Filling, you've just said it, making Labour paralysed in the face of what the Tories are doing because of an internal fight that was mounted within weeks of the man being elected.
George, it was a mistake, and I wish it hadn't happened. But one thing I can't get my head around, mate, this isn't 34 MPs and they're having beef between each other. This is 172, and to dismiss them as warmongers and all Blairites is wrong. It's detrimental.
Well, why have they done it then?
Well, because you don't think we're going to get in. You might think your opinion and my opinion, let's give it a crack and let's give it a chance.
Well, that's how democracy normally works, isn't it? A man runs for election, he wins with 59.9% of the vote, and he gets on with showing us what he can do. But they've never given him a day or hour of peace since the minute that he was first elected.
George, George, you've got to trust me, mate. I support Jeremy Corbyn. It's not that. I just don't like what I'm hearing, mate. I just don't like the approach. I think there's more things we have in common than we have in difference. And I just think the tone and the dismissiveness of Labour MPs who give their lives to the party, good people.
Oh, come on, Mark. Give their lives, good people. Most of them. I sat in Parliament for nearly 30 years. I've never set eyes on most of them. I've never heard their names before. Don't talk to me about people giving their lives to the Labour Party in the context of this coup. Most of them were student politicians that became parliamentary runners for MPs and who sat in the cafeteria looking at MPs, wondering when they were going to fall over and they could get their seats. These are not people that have given their lives, Mark. This is not the Labour Party of old. I've got to go now, but it's been a pleasure disagreeing with you. Go ahead, David.
Hi, George.
Hi, how mate. I'm good, sir.
Hey, listen, hey, I appreciate your show, mate. You're doing brilliant work.
Thank you.
Big time, big time.
Thank you.
Right, what I'm trying to say, right, see, Jeremy Corbyn, right?
Yeah.
If he does get voted in as the Labour leader and he gets voted in to Parliament, right, see, wins the election, would they try to kill him?
Somebody could, and that's one of the reasons why he is given as the leader of the opposition a security cover by the police. We don't, of course, discuss the shape and form of it, but that's why the man's protected, because we have to protect our leaders. There was a book written, a very British coup, by Chris Mullen, you might recall it, former Labour MP, whose whole plot was based around the danger of a coup.
They don't want people like Corbyn in, because he's going to socially change the landscape, but it's politics.
Now, that's why we need a mass movement, David. That's why we need a mass movement behind it. There's no point in just being an MP and being just the PM if you don't have millions of people mobilised behind you in the country. Dave, I've got to press on. Forgive me, because the hour is late. I want to get in Julian in Reading on Brexit. Go ahead, Julian.
Hi there, George. Owen Smith has said he'd have a second EU referendum. Is that right?
That's right. That's what he said, and he thinks it's a vote winner.
Is there any argument for that? I was chatting to a friend the other day, and he said, well, we were misled on the money that would be available for the NHS, etc. So there should be another vote. Is there any legitimacy in that argument?
No, there isn't. A referendum is a referendum is a referendum. You can't have a neverendum, or will never be done. What is legitimate is that a political party, and the Liberal Democrats have already said so, will run for election to be the British government on the pledge that they would seek to rejoin the European Union. That would be legitimate. And if they won the election, they'd have a mandate to seek to rejoin it. More fool them, just as it's falling apart. But that would be legitimate. What isn't legitimate is to say we're going to have referendums until we get the result we're looking for.
But do you think we were misled?
Well, I think people misled the voters in every election and every referendum that's ever been held. But I think the clear majority was that Britain should leave the EU, and I was happy about that result. And I look forward to the moment when it happens. But it's perfectly possible for people, as I say, to have as their platform that they wish to rejoin the European Union. But leave it, we now must.
Great. George, thanks for clearing that one up.
All right, thanks for that, Julian. Gamer Senora says it won't be a low turnout in the US presidential election. I guarantee you that. We will have long lines of people waiting to vote for the President of the United States. I'm not sure about that. Janice Carr says, do you think Blairites have an ideology other than right-wing Tory? They're more right-wing than some Tories. And Neil from Northwest London says, UKIP will get seats if we, he means Labour, keep pulling ourselves apart. Well, actually, UKIP seems to me to be itself falling apart. We've got the donkey derby of would-be successors to Nigel Farage. I don't think that donkey derby is going to yield any thoroughbred winners. So UKIP, Labour now has an opportunity to move in on the UKIP territory and on the former Labour voters that voted for UKIP. Mind you, keep an eye on Aaron Banks and Nigel Farage. What are they going to do next? I'm not sure it involves UKIP. Jill Day says, spot on. I call Smith a cardboard cutout. Will I be purged now? Well, if they can find you. Malcolm Finch says, Corbyn is doing a rope-a-dope to the right-wing media. He'll roll with their punches and then knock them out. And an SMS from, again, an anonymous person says, glad to hear that you're warming to the Foo Fighters, George. This whole leadership contest is a farce. Jeremy Corbyn's the best thing in British politics. He's a man of principle, which is what we need now more than ever. If he loses, we all lose in the long term. And Earthly Delights says, yes, it's so much more comforting to know that Hillary will deploy nukes for the purposes of goodness, not badness. Not for me, it isn't. I'm supporting Dr. Jill Stein, the Green Party candidate. Matthew Austin says, Labour purge songs, anything by the band. Very, very good. Dallow says, Labour purge songs. Corbyn, Bridge Over Troubled Water. That's a very, very good one. And Marie McFarlane, perhaps Angela Eagle and Owen Smith are stalking horses. David Miliband is who they actually want to lead. Well, he'd need to get back into Parliament first, Marie, and I don't see any actual signs of that. If I do, I'll be the first in line to stand against him. Rowan Sutherland says, hope to see Corbyn stay, one of the few politicians who seems genuine and not conceited. Well, that's a fact. Jeremy Corbyn is genuine. He's authentic. He's real. What you see is what you get. Nobody spun him. Nobody varnished him. No lobbyist has bought him. He has always, for well over 30 years now in Parliament, stood up for the working people, for the poor, for the marginalised. He's never put a foot wrong. He's never voted for anything that was wrong. He stood up and defended that which was right. Decade after decade after decade. I sat next to him, literally in most cases, for almost 30 years in Parliament. He never said or did a bad thing. He's a good and honest man. And frankly, if we've reached the stage in Britain where we don't want our potential Prime Minister as the leader of the Labour Party, who's a good and honest man, then there's not much hope for us, to be honest. If we're really saying that we want a mannequin, an empty mannequin, to be our Prime Minister, then we're lost. And I don't think that we are lost. I believe, on the contrary, that the huge mass movement that Corbyn has built up proves that we are not lost. But the problem is, we've only got a few weeks left of this national executive in power, but it has enormous potential to wreck the entire party. And it may well be that that is what it is bent upon doing. And that is a very dangerous place to be. Kyle Williamson says, how about this for a Labour purge song? Things can only get better. And DM Edwards says, the last roundup as a song. Band on the Run, BANNED, says the agitator. And Jojo Williams says, purging me, purging you. Aha, there is nothing we can do. That's fantastic. Teresa Mary says, every picture you take, every tweet you make, I'll be watching you. How wonderful. See how ingenious our listeners are. This is a university of the airwaves. We read, we listen, we seek out knowledge, and we seek out the alternative truth to that which is dished up for us. Now, I don't have a lot of time left, but I'm determined to finish with a good Foo Fighters number in honour of Catherine Starr, who has written her name in the stars as the woman who was purged for effing loving the Foo Fighters. It's been marvellous for me. I hope it was for you. And if it was, God willing, I'll be back in this chair next Friday at the same time. I hope you join me, and I hope you bring at least one extra listener with you. Because I've got to keep my ratings up, you know. Or this could all come to an end all too prematurely. This is George Galloway. This is the mother of all talk shows. This
is the Foo Fighters.